Everyone knows the 555 timer IC, but did you know it can do way more than you'd think? Watch this video to find out about five unusual 555 circuits. Stick around. To understand how these circuits work, we first need to understand how the 555 works. Well, its heart is an RS flip-flop that's driven by two comparators. One of their inputs is connected to a voltage divider with three resistors in series. This means that two-thirds of the supply voltage goes to the negative input of the upper comparator, and one-third goes to the positive input of the other one. When we press the button, the voltage at this inverting input is pulled to zero. So the output of the comparator goes high, the flip-flop is set, and the LED is turned on. When we press the other button, the voltage at the non-inverting input of the upper comparator is 9 volts. This resets the flip-flop and the LED goes off.
That was easy.
If we connect pin 2 and 6, we get an inverting Schmitt trigger that switches at one-third and two-thirds of the supply voltage. In our case, that's 3 and 6 volts. This brings us to our first application. Here we have a simulation of a push button that's bouncing badly. If we now probe the signal at the capacitor at the input of the Schmitt trigger, we can see its red charge and discharge curve. There, the glitches are gone. And at the point where this curve intersects these thresholds, the 555 outputs a clean transition. And without the input signal plot, we can see this even better. I've already described this method in another video, so check it out if you want to know more.
Hey, that's pretty good.
So what's this circuit for? The output pin of the 555 is connected to a resistor in series with a capacitor. When we press the button, the voltage at the negative input of the lower comparator is pulled to almost zero because the capacitor is discharged, so its output gets high and sets the flip-flop, which then sets the output of the 555. When we release the button, the output recharges the capacitor through the resistor. When we press the button again, the positive input of the other comparator gets high, and it resets the flip-flop. You can see the three voltages on the scope below. What we got here is a toggle switch. And the comparators in the 555 can be involved in other useful applications too. Here, the Zener diode keeps the voltage on pin 5 at 4.7 volts. With these two of the built-in resistors, we get half of that, which is 2.35 volts, rounded to 2.4 for simplicity. The voltage on the negative pin changes with the supply voltage. If the supply voltage drops, this voltage drops as well. And if it drops below the voltage on the other input, the flip-flop is set and the MOSFET turns off any load like this lamp. And what is it good for? Well, this circuit can protect your batteries from deep discharge. With the second potentiometer, we can set the threshold at which the circuit is reset after the battery has been recharged. So let's crank the supply voltage up again and watch the lamp.
Nice.
Okay, there is yet another circuit. Look at the 200 milliohm resistor in the current path of the load. When I turn on the second lamp, the voltage on its right-hand side drops, and so does the voltage at the inverting input of the comparator. Because it goes below 4 volts, the flip-flop is set, and the MOSFET cuts off the current. So we have an electronic fuse here. And by pressing the button that's connected to the reset pin, we can put the fuse back in.
It's brilliant.
Here I've combined the deep discharge protection and the fuse into a single protection circuit for all types of batteries. And instead of tediously putting it all together on a prototype board, I made a PCB design in KiCad. By clicking on the PCBWay plugin for KiCad, I sent the Gerber files directly to their order page. This opens their website where we get a preview of the PCBs themselves and also tons of options to choose from. But for most PCB projects, we can leave them as they are. After placing the order, I receive 5 circuit boards. I'm always amazed at their high quality and how they look and feel, and so assembling these boards is fun and done in no time. And I want to mention that PCBWay also offers CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, 3D printing, and injection molding. So check it out. Now let's try this. The first trimmer sets the voltage at which the load is cut off so that the battery is not discharged any further. The second sets the level at which the battery is considered full. There, the circuit switches the load on again, and the third trim pot sets the current at which the fuse will blow. I'm now decreasing the supply voltage to simulate a battery that's being drained. As the voltage goes below 9 volts, the light bulb goes off. Now watch the meter to see how the battery recharges. And as soon as the voltage reaches the upper level of 13 volts, the light goes on again. Now I pop the fuse by shorting the bulb and put it back in. The amplifier that you saw at the beginning is not a fake. But how does it work when the 555 can only switch on and off? Well, PWM is the answer. Here we have a simple oscillator. The output charges a capacitor until its voltage, that's represented by the red trace below, exceeds the upper threshold of 6 volts. Then the output goes low and discharges the capacitor until it reaches the lower threshold of 3 volts, so the 555 switches on again. After that, the next cycle begins. If we change the voltage at pin 5, these thresholds also change, and so does the duty cycle of the output signal. With a low-pass filter at the output, we get a voltage that follows the voltage at pin 5. Since the 555 can deliver up to 200 milliamps of current at its output, while the input current is much less, we have a power amplifier there. This amplifier does not amplify the input voltage, though, so we do also need an additional transistor stage. Now we can see how nicely the actual waveform correlates with the PWM output signal. Let's try with music from the YouTube Creator Music Library. Well, sounds not too bad. This is how the PWM output signal looks on the scope. With the inductance of its coil and its inertia, the speaker itself is the low pass that demodulates it. Now let's compare it with the input signal. Very faint and barely audible. Here again after amplification. Okay, I hope that this video was useful or interesting. If so, give it a thumbs up. Write a comment down below and check out the other videos on my channel. And subscribe and enable notifications to never miss any of my future videos. Thank you for watching.